Commission. It's been a while since I've been before the commission. I appreciate this opportunity. I hope you find a couple of things I got here interesting today. So, first, I want to talk about a recent project we completed at Lake Yankton down in Yankton County. Lake Yankton is really a unique resource just because of the whole complicated situation down there. It is a border water with Nebraska. It was kind of formed when Gavin's Point Dam was built. Lake Yankton, as I understand, was actually part of the original Missouri River Channel, and the formation of the dam kind of cut that off, and it formed the lake. The fishery is actually managed by the state of Nebraska. The Nebraska managers and biologists do all the survey work and make the management recommendations. However, South Dakota Game Fish and Parks, the Corps of Engineers, and the Fish and Wildlife Service all cooperate in the management of the lake. That's what makes it such a unique resource. Lake Yankton, when it's at its best, it has an abundance of aquatic vegetation. It's a nice clear body of water, and it over the past decade or so, it's had a really good fishery for largemouth bass, bluegill, channel catfish, and they also manage some bonus walleye in there. It is a valuable resource to that area and heavily used by citizens from both states. So, why did we need to kill it off? Why was a chemical renovation needed? Well, during the 2011 Missouri River flood, Lake Yankton has an outlet structure, and during the flood, water backflowed up through that outlet structure into the lake, and the Asian carp came up through that outlet structure and entered the lake, and they entered in pretty decent numbers by what we found after the renovation. These Asian carp primarily, and especially the grass carp, virtually eliminated the aquatic vegetation in the lake when the lake was drawn down. We didn't find a sprig of green on the bottom of that lake anywhere. As a result of that, these species I described before, they're really heavily dependent on aquatic vegetation, and their abundance declined, and likewise, fishing pressure and success went down with it. Just as a brief update, Asian carp are in South Dakota. Their spread, however, has been limited by the barriers that currently exist at Yankton, at Gavin's Point Dam, on the Vermilion River system by the East Vermilion Dam, and in Sioux Falls by the falls in Sioux Falls. So far, the Asian carp have not made it over those barriers and spread throughout the state. However, on the James River, they have gone all the way through the state and all the way up to the first major dam in North Dakota. And that's our primary concern at this time, because we all know the James River has many tributaries, and there are some vectors for them to spread beyond that. Planning for the Lake Yankton renovation started in 2013. All the partners I mentioned before, Nebraska, South Dakota, the Corps, and the Fish and Wildlife Service partnered together on this project. The cost of the chemical for the project was about $40,000. This chemical is very expensive, and I'll show you why in just a minute, but part of the project was drawing down the lake 4 feet, and this was made possible due to that outlet structure, and that 4 foot drawdown alone saved $60,000 in chemical costs. So when we do these renovation projects, one of the criteria we look for is this ability to draw down a water, because it really saves on the chemical cost. Just most people don't know what this chemical is, and rotenone is a chemical that's extracted from the roots of certain tropical plants that are in the pea and bean family. Basically, they're related to soybeans. This rotenone chemical is related to soybeans. And it's been used in tropical areas for centuries by the native populations to capture fish for food. They just gather up these roots, they put them on a log in the stream, and they beat the roots until the chemical comes out of them, and it disperses, and the fish come floating up. It's been used as a fish management tool in North America since the 1930s. And it's also used as an insecticide for pets and livestock and organic gardening. It is an organic substance. It's not synthesized. How does it work? Well, quite simply, it breaks down the cellular process that transfers oxygen from the bloodstream into the cells. And so the cells can't use the oxygen, and essentially the fish suffocate. And usually the first sign of all this is the fish come to the surface and start gasping for air. But it does work quite quickly. One of the questions we frequently get, is it toxic to humans or other air-breathing animals? Not when ingested orally. Our digestive systems and the digestive systems of animals break down this chemical by heat and other processes before it can get into our bloodstream, and it's not particularly toxic if you ingest it. You'd have to drink thousands and thousands of gallons of rotenone treated water to have any effect. For those same reasons, the animals that would eat dead fish or drink from waters treated with rotenone, they're not harmed either. However, there is some risk if you inhale this chemical at high concentrations, especially when it's used in its powdered form. That's because you're inhaling the chemical and putting it right into your lungs, right next to that oxygen transfer system, and that's where it can be a little more dangerous for you. So that's why we wear protective gear when we're handling the concentrated forms. Another question we get during these projects is people see all these fish out there, and geez, it'd be sure nice if we could use those some way. Can we eat them? Well, theoretically, yes. Of course, the natives eat them when they use it. But you know, in our day and age, in modern society, you know, we need the FDA and the EPA to make sure everything's safe before we can recommend that. But there's no guidelines on that. So, you know, when we do projects like this, we say no, don't touch the fish. It's not a good idea. Not only that, you're picking up dead fish. You don't know for sure how long they've been dead. And we all know as fishermen and everything that you want as fresh a fish as possible so you don't have any bacterial issues. And then finally, when we're using the liquid form of the chemical, it's combined with a petroleum-based solvent. And if you're around a project, there's a pretty heavy chemical, petroleum type smell involved with it, and I personally have taken fish that have been killed by a rotenone project and cut them open and filleted them and stuff, and you can put your nose to that fillet and you can pick up that petroleum smell pretty heavily. How long does it remain toxic? Well, it degrades quite quickly when exposed to light, heat, oxygen, and alkalinity. And in general, 1 to 8 weeks at water temps of 50 to 68 degrees, that varies considerably, just depending on the amount of sunlight you get, how warm the water temperatures are. And the test is really simple to see if it's still toxic. We just put a cage of fish in the lake, and if they survive for a few days, the lake's good to go for restocking. Rotenone can be applied by many ways. During the Lake Yankton project, boat application was the primary method. Nebraska does many of these projects every year, and they were the agency that had all the equipment and the expertise and everything. They were set up, so they did the majority of the applications. A boat like this is equipped with a barrel of chemical and a pumping system. You have one part of the pumping system disperses the chemical behind the boat, and another outlet on the pumping system has a weighted hose on it that goes down deep. The effectiveness of these projects is determined by how good you are at getting this chemical dispersed through the water column. Drip stations are also used. The Lake Yankton project was unique in that Lake Yankton also functions as a flow-through system for the tow drains on Gavin's Point Dam. So when you draw the lake down, you see all these little springs coming out from underneath the dam. And every one of those little springs had to be set up with a drip station like this, and there were over 30 of them involved in the Lake Yankton project. So that was quite a bit of the logistical issues with this project is getting all these set up. And it's important to do these so you don't have any refuge for those fish to find to avoid the chemical. We also did some hand spraying. This is where South Dakota's crew came in. Again, there were some mud flats and things out there that had some of these springs in them that we couldn't reach with the drip stations, you know, to get the big barrels down there. So our staff cruised up and down the shoreline with this spray rig, and we kept those springs well saturated with chemical for a few hours during the project. Well, here's what happened. Just a few minutes after, you know, within 30 minutes after the start of the application of the chemical, fish started coming to the surface, and they came up in numbers that we were surprised about even, and especially when it comes to the Asian carp. You know, the first sign, you'll see fish like in the upper right-hand corner, like that large flathead there, you know, they just kind of come up and are starting to show some distress, but then after a while they start coming up in really large numbers and expiring. This is an example of one of the largest fishes that came up during the deal. This big head carp was over 50 pounds, and it just an example of how easily these fish can get into a body of water. The outlet structure there was flowing quite hard, and it wasn't easy for those fish to get in, but they were attracted to it, and they got in there in good numbers. And this is just a representation of all the different species of fish that expired during the project. If you look closely, there's our entire game fish population essentially right there. And you know, an oddball big catfish and paddlefish. But once this project was over and we saw the species composition of the fish, there was no question in anybody's mind that this project was justified and successful, and we'll have some real benefits to the lake. Nebraska has already stocked fish this year. Once the lake detoxified late this fall, largemouth bass and bluegill were stocked. And next year, bass, catfish, crappie, and walleye will be added, and they'll do supplemental stockings down the road after that to get this lake up and running as fast as possible. And we're expecting that vegetation to be back next year and get this lake off and running again. Does anybody have any questions or anything about, yes?
What's the fill back level of a lake? The 4 foot to 2 feet, does that come back pretty fast?
Yeah, it's already full again. The infiltration rate of that tow drain water is pretty fast, and it didn't take long at all for the lake to refill. Okay, moving on to shallow lakes management. I am the regional fisheries manager for the southeastern portion of the state, and managing this part of the state creates some interesting management challenges. We, in this part of the state, we just don't have the an abundance of the real quality lakes like they've got in the Northeast, like your Roy Lakes and your Wabe Lakes and stuff. The lakes I manage are pretty much typical, the one you see on the picture here. They're shallow prairie lakes. Most of them are less than 10 feet deep, 10 foot deep, and this creates a lot of challenges. But there's ways that we've been dealing with that. Essentially, shallow lakes exist in one of two states. The turbid water state is typified by poor water clarity. You almost have no submerged vegetation. Very few of my lakes have a lot of submerged vegetation in them. They frequently get heavy algae blooms. Just because they're shallow and they get stirred up, the nutrients in the bottom of the lake feed algae populations. They usually have large populations of undesirable fish like carp and bullheads. Those species are most suited for surviving in these types of environments, and we get frequent fish kills. It all depends on the winter, but when we get a lot of snowfall early in the year, we usually get quite a few fish kills. The Clearwater state and the desired state would be just the opposite of everything. It would have good water clarity, we'd have lots of vegetation, very few algae blooms, we'd have good game fish populations, minimal undesirable fish, and less frequent fish kills. So all of our management techniques on shallow lakes are geared to try to convert these things to the Clearwater state. Of course, the challenge of managing a lot of waters like this is you're maintaining your fishing opportunity. You know, we're pretty aggressive in our management techniques, and it seems like we just get things going and then we suffer a winter kill or a significant summer kill, and often our efforts are set back. But we do have some strategies that we implement to make the most out of our resource, and they include stockings, aggressive surveying, biomanipulation techniques, and aeration and circulation. Stocking is what we use most frequently. It's the least expensive. However, it has variable results. Sometimes we're stocking into large populations of rough fish, and it's hard to get them going. And you know, one of the most, and it takes time to recover a fishery. And you know, one of the things I hear most often from people that are as old as Cooper and I is that I don't have much time left. You know, we don't have time to mess around with rebuilding these fisheries all the time. So, God, can't you do something to keep them from killing? So that's one of our challenges. One of the things we've implemented just this year is an aggressive survey regime. Normally on these shallow lakes, we'd only survey them every 2 to 3 years. It's just a logistics thing. We've got over 50 waters that we manage in the Southeast, and it's hard to get to all these. However, that lag in survey time creates gaps in our information. You know, we stock a lake after a winter kill and we don't get back to it for 2 or 3 years. We see, oh man, our stocking didn't take hold, and now we're out to 5-6 years before we get a fishery going. And that was always frustrating to us as managers. So this year we implemented an annual lake survey program. And in order to get 50 lakes done in one survey season, which is only 2.5 months long, we had to make some changes to our sampling protocols. And most of those changes involve just cutting down the amount of effort. If you take a lake that we're only managing for perch and walleyes, We cut our sampling. We'd normally sample that with gill nets and trap nets over a 1 or 2 day period. Now we just use a minimal number of gill nets. We get in and out in 2 days, and we move on to the next water. It gives us the critical information we need to manage the fishery, and it greatly reduces our time per lake out there. So it worked well this year. A little bit of tweaking to do, but we feel we're really on the right track here. Biomanipulation is basically a term we use to basically mess with the system out there and try to get those undesirable fish under control. There's a number of techniques we can use for that. We can subsidize our commercial fishermen to help us out. We can install fish barriers, which we have done in a few instances. We can do the total chemical renovations, similar to what we did at Lake Yankton, to get these things turned around faster. And we can even use our own staff, like we have done in the past, to physically go in and reduce those undesirable populations and try to convert them to the clear water state. Another technique we use is aggressive predator stocking and management. And one of the ways to get our undesirable fish populations under control is to make sure we have enough predators in there. Of course, our predators have to survive the winter kills and everything like everything else, so it's a challenge at times. But through aggressive walleye and pike stocking, and even in one case, a special walleye size limit. We have been effective at times in converting these lakes over to the clear water state. Aeration and circulation is really something. It's been around a long time. A lot of states have used it to some effect. In South Dakota as a state, we don't use it as an agency very much. Stockade Lake out in the Black Hills is one of the exceptions, and our biologists out there are confident it's accomplishing its objectives there. In shallow lakes, however, it's a little bit less effective, mainly because of the zone of influence. When these bubbles come off the bottom, the amount of ice that they open up depends on how far that bubble stream can spread by the time it reaches the surface. And when you've got a lake that's only 6 to 10 feet deep, it just doesn't have a whole lot of time to spread. And the key to preventing winter kill is to get as much open water out there as you can. It's expensive. The equipment is expensive. The electricity costs to operate it are expensive. And then you have the safety and liability issues with creating open water during our winter periods. But we're taking another look at aeration. One of the things we really want to do is cost benefits analysis. Are there benefits to be gained in license sales and angler participation and opportunity, you know, if we keep these lakes alive year after year versus only creating a good fishery once every 5 to 10 years when we have to constantly restock? So those are some of the things we're looking at. Having that opportunity and things may offset the costs of this in some situations. So we're taking a fresh look at it. Many of the things I just mentioned are actually identified in our new strategic plan for Eastern South Dakota. Like I just mentioned, we're going to look at aeration and circulation. We are already in the process of evaluating our aggressive stocking strategies. We're using new stocking rates, different sizes of fish. We're looking at various aspects of that, especially in the category of yellow perch. Many states around us have been working on shallow lake management longer than we have. We're going to review their literature and talk to their people and see what's working for them. And finally, we want to continue to evaluate the effectiveness of nuisance fish control. I often say it's similar to Canada thistles. We're never going to get rid of them, but can we derive some benefits by exerting constant pressure and keeping after it? So, in summary, in eastern South Dakota, and especially in the southeastern region, our demand for quality fishing opportunity is really high. We're limited by the number of quality resources that we have in the southeast region, so we really focus our efforts on our shallow lakes, and it's more important than ever. And we are actively working on several strategies to make these shallow lakes, get the most out of them that we can. So thank you for your time, and I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Questions for Todd? Go ahead, Jim.
Going back to your first presentation on Lake Yankton, when you drew it down 4 feet, you did looked like a heck of a job on the fish kill. What happens to frogs and turtles?
They are not affected. As an air-breathing animal, they're not killed by this chemical. So, in all honesty, we didn't. Of course, you draw it down slow, so it wasn't like there was a bunch of them running around or anything, but I don't recall seeing a frog or turtle during the whole project. So only animals that take in water breathe through the process of ingesting water are harmed by this. So
Barry, go ahead.
A couple of questions on the Lake Yankton. Good presentation.
Thank you.
Did you have to pick up all those fish, or what did you do with the dead fish?
No, the dead fish were left on the shorelines, and that's a common practice in these projects. The nutrient release from the dead carcasses, the nutrients that go back into the lake, actually help fuel the early productivity of the lake. As those nutrients are released, they feed the zooplankton and start the food chain going again, so the stocking and the vegetation and all that get a jump start on the restoration phase of the project.
So. Oh yeah, I suppose that's a little smelly for a while there.
It is smelly for a little while. I could have showed you pictures as we were doing this and the fish were coming up. We had hundreds of gulls descending on the area, and Mother Nature, especially when the warmer temperatures and stuff we had in September, cleaned these things up pretty quickly. Oh, yeah. So,
and then on winter kill, I've heard that snow cover on the ice also affects that. Is that true?
Absolutely. We all know that photosynthesis produces oxygen. It's the same in our aquatic systems. You have the algae and the vegetation in the water that produce oxygen, and then during the open water, you have the air-water interface that puts oxygen into the water. When you cover a lake with ice and then cover it with snow, first of all, you cut off the air-water interchange, and then you cut off the sunlight to produce it, and the heavy snowfall definitely contributes to winter kill.
Other questions for Todd? Nice job, Todd.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for being here.